all table. Very funny. Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Right, right. I'm not whispering. There's been some reports that I've been whispering, and I'm sure you I'm not whispering. Okay. Welcome to today's meeting. Hi Mike, how are you? Have we got any apologies?
Yes, Chair. Apologies to Councillor Jones, Councillor Maguire and Councillor Baines.
Anyone else?
Councillor Leach.
Thank you.
Please. Thank you.
Darrell, okay. Declarations of interest. If you have any declarations of interest, there are some forms up here on the...
Yes, they are.
To fill in. And can you also make your declaration known? Can we take the minutes of the last meeting?
Agreed.
All those in favour? Yeah? Matters arising? Any matters arising? No? Okay.
Talk through Chair, state of play is probably the simplest way of hopefully briefing you, given you kind of the up-to-date position, but also hopefully anticipating one or two questions and areas of questioning that members might have at this particular point. So the negotiation process is continuing at pace. It literally is moving almost by the hour at this stage of the process. We have continued to make headway on the priorities that I shared with you last time, which were around development and transport, planning for growth and housing, skills and employment. And we are continuing to try and negotiate, of course, the best deal that we can in terms of powers, which are always very helpful, but most importantly, resources, because they are even more helpful than the powers are. Clearly, there's a link between those two issues, and each of the range of assets that we've been negotiating with government fall down into that kind of direct financial asset or a powers asset. And clearly at the end of the process, which I'll say more about in a minute, we will come to the ability of each individual authority to take a view on the balance of those two things in terms of what I described to you last time and what we've been saying in all the conversations, the size of the prize that we've been able to negotiate at that particular point, as opposed to the price to be paid for it, which is the opportunity for us to move attention to a city region, for a city region area, then the price issues that was come to in a second. So, you forgive me, Chair, for obvious reasons, I won't go through each line of the negotiations at this particular point. percentage terms, we're probably about maybe 90% through the range of things that we've been looking to negotiate, and we've been successful in getting in principle agreement to that 90%, and the balance is what we'll be discussing, leaders and the mayor will be discussing with Lord Hazeltine and his team tomorrow, and we anticipate there'll be a further meeting next week with one of the other Treasury ministers that will be the final opportunity to be able to reach a balanced view on the negotiations, and at that point the negotiations will close and then we will get it to our own internal levels, both collectively across the city region and obviously individually each of the constituent authorities around assessing that price issue, the way that I was broadly describing it a second or two ago. So the timetable now becomes incredibly tight. It's been tight all the way through, of course, but we're now absolutely at the kind of 11th hour, 50-odd minutes worth of the negotiation outcomes. And we are still working to an assumption that the Chancellor will hopefully make an announcement either on the 25th of November in the autumn statement, which is the original timetable we were working to. An announcement at that point, obviously anticipate it will be a favourable announcement, otherwise it probably wouldn't say anything, or it might even be ahead of that 25th of November, so that shows you how quantitative the timetable is that we're working to. And we will be looking to reach that kind of rounded view about price issues, as I say, over the next, through the next 4 minutes or so. Just to reinforce, Chair, a couple of points that I made at the last scrutiny panel, and will obviously be of concern to each of the authorities. To re-emphasise, this is about drawing devolutionary responsibilities and resources from national government to the city region, as opposed to being coming up from each of the constituent authorities. I'm anticipating that there will be some concerns still around that issue as we move towards each of the constituent authorities taking that view over the next few weeks. In there, there will be naturally some concerns about what the state of play around governance is, because the one thing that we've done all the way through here is to look to negotiate in terms of the proposals and the asks in economic development, transport, skills and employment, all those other thematic areas that I touched on. And we've kept the issue of governance to one side because of the obvious sensitivities and obvious difficulties we've been able to resolve that at this particular point, because I think all of our assumptions would be that would have dominated the conversation of the content of the negotiations. And so we've been at great pains to focus on the content of the negotiations, the shape of the prize issue. But we have obviously started to give some consideration to how governments might work, assuming that we move in this particular direction. And the leaders and the mayor have received a presentation on the principles of how governments might work. So there is no more detail than literally the principles. But just to rehearse the principles, the working assumption, and it's only a working assumption, will be that whoever the city region mayor is, have one, and that will come through in May 2017, just to recap on the timetable, that's when any election will take place. And we would assume that that person would work with the combined authority as is, and would work with the framework of the combined authority, which obviously works on an assumption in terms of certain checks and balances within the constitution of the combined authority. And naturally, obviously, to your group and chair this morning, the importance of scrutiny will be one of those key principles about how this will work in practice going forward. Clearly, all the detail of this needs to be worked through between the end of the negotiations, and assessment by each of the authorities and the command authority. We anticipate those will finish around the kind of the end of November, just to put a time scale on it. If we are going to move forward in terms of the new governance arrangement, clearly we'll have to spend a lot of time between the end of November and the May 2017 timetable to work through exactly how these things are actually going to work through between the combined authority, the roles and responsibilities of individual cabinet. let buses, because the let bus clearly a very important part of this equation as well, and then how those do or don't fit with the existing constituent authorities. So if you forgive me, Chair, there'd be loads of questions around that, naturally, so I assume that's been the case, but there are not the answers to those questions as things stand today. I'm more happy to share whatever I can with you, but we are deliberately not been addressing those kind of issues in any detail at this particular point. Those conversations and dialogues and considerations will have to flow from the outcome of the prize issue, which I think we're writing as the kind of state of play literally at the moment. So, finish off, Chair, on 2 points of a night. One is that we've worked very hard at improving the communication and the engagement of the subject matter of this issue, recognising that we haven't played the negotiations out in public because we wouldn't, but recognising that we've made great steps since your meeting on 24th of September to do a lot of things within each of the constituent authority areas, and also to engage stakeholder kind of groupings across the city area. So hopefully people have got a better understanding, not necessarily a full understanding, but a better understanding of what the devolution framework is, what it isn't, what's going to happen in the first phase, what might happen in the second phase, and this issue again, sorry to make the point, but the price strategy that we've been adopting so far. So welcome any feedback that members have got around that particular issue. First thing I would say, of course, around communications is we will need to continue to improve and work hard on communications and engagements from this point going forward. The second point that I'll just dwell on, Chair, is that the timetable literally is the next round of formal negotiations with Lord Heseltine tomorrow. We're hoping that by pushing forward on the things that remain to be negotiated that have not yet been agreed in principle, that we will convert the 90% to to 98-99%, with the fallback of a meeting with the senior Treasury Minister next week. At that point, after that meeting, which is probably going to be in London next week, the veil will be drawn on the negotiations. The government will withdraw on its side.
Sullivan.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks for an excellent report. We've been keeping a close eye on this, on the Wirral, and from all over the water. My concerns are the speed of this. And there was a supposed government leak from the Cabinet saying that our bid was very weak and it looked in danger. And I've heard from Phil Davis, actually, that he knew nothing about it. But that's a concern, if that was to come, supposedly from the Cabinet. I wouldn't think our bid is weak because of the authorities. And what we've been told on the Wirral, we had a group meeting on Monday night, that we're going to have a devolution full council meeting on the 19th. I don't know if other members here are aware of this, but all the regions are going to have a council meeting, on that night, and we're all going to agree or disagree on the same night, which I think is good. Can you elaborate any more on the 10%? It's good to hear that we think we've got 90% of our ask so far, and I do think, and this is rich coming from me, I think Heseltine has done some good work on this, going back a few years now. He's got a track record, not on my time in when he was Minister for Liverpool, I think it was awful, but probably since then, he's got quite a good track record on local government, so I'm hopeful there. But I know it's delicate, but can you elaborate any more at this stage on the 10% that we're not sure? And I would concur with Kevan about the governance. I think we're all concerned, and the thing that concerns me most, are we getting devolved powers? Or are we getting devolved powers to implement cuts? That's a big concern. Thank you. Thanks, Chair.
Chair, may I answer those as best I can. Clearly, the leak that you referred to was entirely inappropriate and acting entirely inaccurate. But nonetheless, very frustrating for those of us who've been kind of working quite hard at this and find that we are deflected away from continuing the negotiation process and getting to the end of where we need to get to in order to answer media queries that are entirely speculative and well out of date, as I say, inaccurate. But we are now where we are, and that has been addressed both locally and nationally, as my understanding. In terms of the 10%, you'll expect me to play a straight bat on that one this morning for very obvious reasons. But what I would say is that the best way of describing it is that these are the ones that will determine whether or not the balance of the prize is as attractive to us as it might otherwise be. And why do I say that? Because the negotiations have been on parallel tracks, really, in terms of people like myself negotiating with the equivalent officials in government departments, particularly Treasury, around this issue. And naturally, as they do with my own role in Liverpool and the equivalent of your own offices in Wirral, you get to a certain point where you kind of know that you're on safe ground, but beyond that, it has to be a full council or a political decision. And there, some of these are in that 10% issue. And they will be asked very clearly, very directly, tomorrow with Lord Heseltine, and then if necessary, beyond that next week. And that will kind of give us the ability to know whether the 90% becomes the 98-99% that I was referring to, or whether we kind of get to 91-92%. And I'm quietly confident that we will be the top end of this rather than pretty much where we stand at the moment. That's not my decision making, and at the moment, not even the leaders and the mayor's decision making. It will be national government, political decision making about whether it actually shifts in that direction or not. But we are doing that to get the week out to make sure that it does, and that's really the point behind the question. I appreciate the points that you make around governance, of course, and it is natural and at this point inevitable that there will be more questions and answers around how the governance model will work. But I deliberately drew the parallel with the combined authority because of the role that establishment of a combined authority from that point of view, its constitution, its ways of working, what its role would be, wouldn't be, how it would impact on constituent authorities. I would suggest that I've actually abated and used away over that time scale, and the active role that you specifically, obviously this morning, the active role that you play in scrutinising what we can in terms of the role of the combined authority and so on, I think bears that out in terms of kind of a sensible, practical, and efficient way of being able to manage the administration of what we're actually talking about. So I think that when we get to the detail of governance, I would be amazed if the concerns about too much power sitting in one person's hands as a mayor actually becomes a reality. Why do I say that? Because there's a kind of working assumption about the politics of this and about the practicalities of it, naturally. The one person versus six authorities is not the easiest of matches, even for the most significant one person, whoever that might be. But also, exactly the same kind of conversations are taking place in the other devolution areas. So, Greater Manchester, in South Yorkshire, in the North East, which is an area I still know pretty well. And exactly the same dynamics around those kind of things. And they've opted in favour of a mayor subject to council decision making and subject to further conversations about how governance is going to work in each of those areas. And I don't see that we would be radically different than any of those other areas in terms of the arrangements that will need to play out. But of course, that needs to be discussed and rehearsed locally. And we need to develop a set of arrangements that makes sense for each of the constituent authorities and the combined authority, and gives those checks and balances around who can do what within that kind of framework. But that's a, if you forgive me, that's a next week conversation rather than a today conversation.
I have to apologise to members of the public for this, because this may seem somewhat cloak and dagger in some respects, and whilst it's not supposed to be, because of the nature of the negotiations and the sensitivity of the negotiations, there's not a lot we can actually speak about. Things may change from this week to next week, and we don't want to be giving any sort of false information to anybody. I mean, not only the English general public, but us and our constituents, authorities within the combined authority too. Just a comment that Mr. Castle Sullivan is quite right. All councillors within the combined authority were meeting on the 19th of November. You would have led groups by the people who have inserted groups by the. So you have a clear view of where the authority is going to go back in 19. Then we'd have to see what happens after that. I am assuming that the governance question will have been sorted by then. We will have something to get our teeth into, so to speak, by that point.
I think there's a balance, Chair, between the amount of detail and information that you might require at this meeting, but also at the council meetings that you refer to, as opposed to the principles. Because clearly, my own kind of view on this is that it's in the principles. If we get the framework of the principles right, obviously we'll have to put more detail on those, and there will be more discussion about the detail and the exact nature of it. But I think you will be reassured by the principles in terms of exactly how this is expected to work out.
Before I begin, just one last question from me, and that is, whether there be rumours or not,
far be it for me to comment on rumours, Chair, but the I think the simplest way of addressing that issue is that, that there's broadly two types of devolution negotiations taking place throughout the country at the moment. And again, this is jargon, so I apologise, but there's Devo Max conversations, which are the kind of ones we're currently engaged in, which are around trying to clearly get the maximum amount of powers and resources devolved to areas in return for a city region. And that's undoubtedly the equation, the Devo Max calculation. There are a range of Devo Min conversations taking place, which will have less powers and less resources devolved to them because they don't have to pay a price of a city region or shire. It is irrelevant in that context. As things stand, of course, today we are still on the track of a Devo Max deal with the city region around that kind of issue. I don't know of any place that is entirely satisfied with the outcome of the devolution conversation so far, even those that have agreed in principle to move to a city region like South Yorkshire and the North East specifically, because some of those details are still being worked through in those places and will continue to be worked through in those places. But there is clearly in each of the authorities and combined authority an opportunity to opt out or to withdraw from the agreement at any point. And I should make a point also, the government has the opportunity to withdraw from it because it's a deal. You know, it's a negotiated deal between two groups of parties in that sense. So that is the state of play as I understand. And anything that has beyond that may well be such a suggestion.
Could you just, I know you're the new member, but could you just give us your name before you speak?
Councillor Cllr. Thanks. I think the point and diagram aspect of it is understandable, but it's a real shame to think one of the recent aspects of this is taking a look with us. There's quite a lot of, like I say, rumour. And people may be reading into things what are not there. Public may be reading into what our intentions are around a mayor. But I think the potential is enormous. I think it's quite clear that bringing those powers to the region and having us have our own say over how we economic development, you know, how we sort out transport, housing, planning for growth. In other areas, I mean, in the past, there's had to be a referendum over a mayor. Is that not the case anymore? And also, I was just wondering as well, would there be any revenue raising powers along with the devolution?
Chair, the position on referenda is, the government's position on referenda is that it is negotiating with leaders of constituent authorities to effectively move to a new governance arrangement if they choose to do so, if they recommend to their councils to do so, outside of any requirements of a formal referendum in the way that your question implied. You should bear in mind also that the legislation that governs all of this ultimately, the government side of this as well as our own, is still working its way through. So none of us yet know exactly whether there will be any provision either for or against that kind of issue at this point. But the deals that have been done so far are, as it were, voluntary. They've negotiated deals with a recommendation to each constituent authority, and then each constituent authority decides whether it wishes to take advantage of that deal or not, as the case may be. Clearly, the one thing that is very clear is that if we move in this direction, that there will be an election of a city region mayor. That is the outcome of the negotiations in May 2017. That's as much as I can say on that particular issue. On the issue of revenue raising powers, we continue to fight government on this particular issue because not just ourselves, but all of the areas involved in devolution at the moment are looking to push the boundaries on that particular issue. But the government hasn't conceded yet on any particular significant, what they call a fiscal issue, which is broadly tax-based or revenue-raising powers. changes to business rates and other government financing would potentially leave us short, and therefore if we were able to be able to top those kind of things up through local revenue rates of powers in the way that your question applied, would obviously help our positions individually and collectively. But at the moment it's tricky to get a kind of positive outcome on those, but we will continue. Sure, there's plenty we can do to improve the public relations aspect of it. The point I made in my earlier comments was that we are the first people to recognise that this has been done very quickly. Councillor Sullivan had made that point himself. It's on top of all of our day jobs, and it's on top of all the other challenges that, as you know, that we're kind of trying to address at the moment. And we have improved communication and engagement. That is quite genuine as a statement, but it's not perfect. To continue to work hard at this and in trying to explain to lay people, residents and council taxpayers what the costs and benefits of this arrangement might actually be, and to continue to demystify a lot of this, because it's all incredibly, those of us that are professional in this kind of world, we struggle sometimes to keep on top of some of the changes that happen and some of the implications of those changes. Trying to explain that to lay people is almost impossible. Trying to get that across in a concise form through whatever form of media becomes very challenging as well. And then when you get the misinformation and the rumours that you also refer to, that doesn't help to kind of try to get some light onto this issue rather than occasional bits of heat. But we just need to continue to work in that direction. And a genuine point again, Chair, the more that people have an informed perspective like yourselves to a point, like leaders, of course, to a point, like officers, certain officers, to a point, who can explain this to other people, that becomes a bit easier to be able to manage as well going forward.
Again, could you just mention your name, please?
Councillor O'Brien. Is the role of the mayor negotiable, or is it going to be this mystical person is going to be all part of the city, or would it be like the chair of the City of Leeds, and we would have other members of the cabinet to do
it? First point to make, Chair, is the detail of this needs to be worked through. We made a point earlier that I anticipate that the arrangement would be working with the cabinet and working with the combined authority and the LAPA as is. That is more within our collective gift as the constituent authorities around this than it is around it being imposed in the way that the Chair's question earlier have the rumours and belief. But it's too early for me to be able to give you all of the reassurances on that, because those conversations are still taking place and will continue to take place, I imagine, for a couple of months into the future before we get to the exact answers on that. But what I'm trying to reassure you on is that the kind of checks and balances that you would all expect to be in there, I expect to be in there as well. But of course, this is all new, so none of us know exactly how this is going to play out at this point, given that if we are moving to this, the point I've made a couple of times is the first formal step in it, most formal step in it, will be the election of a mayor 18 months from now. So there's a long time to catch up and work through a lot of these kind of details and these issues over that period of time.
Anybody else? Okay. I'd like to ask the panel if there's anything they would want to feed back to the combined authority on that, or the place to Castle on Gray. Maybe one of those surrounding in governance theme. So has anybody got anything that we can pass up, or any concerns that they can discuss at the next meeting?
Thanks, Jeff. I think at this stage that's a bit preemptive, because the negotiations are so fluid and it's changing by the hour, I would think. So I think what we've got, what I personally think is, what we've got to do is wait until, I think on the 19th, what we're going to be asked for is just a vote in principle on the way forward. I think there's going to be a recommendation made to us by all our leaders, just in principle, because within the next 12 months, 6 months, 3 months, 3 weeks, after we move forward in principle on the offer that we're going to get, and whether we're going to accept it or reject it, at this stage I would think we're going to accept. And then we're going to start working through the governance and the elected mayor and everything else that goes with it. Some of the stuff we like and some of the stuff undoubtedly we won't be too happy with. But I think at this stage, I mean, what's happened today, is, I really appreciate it, and it's brought us up to date again, which is important. But I think to make recommendations at this stage, Chair, is a little bit through the cart before the horse.
They're not so much recommendations as concerns as they've put forward. You've got two bites of the cherry next. You've got it for your own constituents council, and you've got it officially from this body going forward. Now this is the only chance that this body may get before a decision, and that's what I'm going to try to go from here. If there's anything that you wish them to discuss or to take into consideration when they meet at their next meeting, this is the time to do it.
I think, Chair, I can actually understand what you're saying, but I can certainly agree with the point that Mike is saying, because if you ask all the six of those, do you actually agree with devolution, all six will say yeah. Do you agree with an elected mayor with a cabinet, all six will say yeah. Do you agree with devolution and an all-powerful mayor? You will not get a consensus on that, and that is the most important issue of the lot.
Yes.
We can't make we can't make a judged response to this until we know exactly what the governance is going to be. I do welcome the Chief Executive's comments on it. It wasn't an answer to the question, and he's quite right not to answer it in the way that it was put, but he answered it in a way that he was understanding it. And I think we should welcome that, because then, if that is the case, I am sure we could get unanimity amongst all six authorities.
Just let me clarify my point here, and that is, this is probably the last meeting we're going to have before a decision has been made. All I'm asking for, if members have any concerns surrounding any of the negotiations with government or any governance issues, and we should prepare them now so they go into the discussion pot at the next full combined authority meeting. That's all. That's all. I understand where Councillor Sullivan's come from. There may not be enough information. But we can only discuss the information we've got in front of us today. And this is the chance to prevent any of those concerns we have today. Okay. Councillor Burns.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Just you said we have two bites of the cherry at this, and I think it's very important for us to understand our roles in each of them two bites. Yeah, in one hand, we're those politicians representing our residents, and so we're going to be talking about the whole structure arrangements. But on this bite, we're coming. I think it's very important that we understand we're going from a scrutiny point of view, so we make sure that all our asks and our questions. From that point of view, certain questions or themes that I would sort of like to go back to the panel will be around the structure of us and how we can be supportive. So we would need some guidance on some issues, because all of this is new, as we said. But also, we need to send out the message that we do need to uphold our role as critical friend too. So yeah, we'll have guidance on things, and yeah, there may be areas where the combined offer
can I also just add as well on the issue of a cabinet, or shall I say supportive set of members to the mayor, to try and ensure that there's some opposition voices on that body as well. This body here, the scrutiny panel, works on that sort of basis, and I think that's useful to ensure that there's some checks and balances, additional checks and balances in that system.
What we